Good morning and welcome to the keynote, Sustainable Management Strategies for Safe Coastal Areas. It is based on studies that have been carried out through many different projects, national projects as RITMARE and European funded projects, such as the FP7 project Theseus that has been recently awarded through the application Smart Coast by the Horizon Impact Award, and the H 2020 project Pre-Guide. We will first have a look at the vulnerabilities and opportunities of coastal areas and then planning strategies, including building with nature approaches, multifunctional structures and multi-hazard defenses, and then decision making and specifically GIS-based support tools. We are well aware that coastal areas are threatened by many hazards, and we had some recent disasters due to typhoons, to hurricanes, storm surges, rainfalls, and flash floods and tsunamis. And basically, there is a strong relation between all the different kind of economic activities and their growth in coastal areas and the vulnerability of coastal areas. And therefore, the development of coastal areas from one side is affected and affects in turns the vulnerability of these areas. As an example, we have from one side extreme sea levels, changing sediment supply and onset subsidence and climate change exacerbation, and at the same time, maritime traffic and coast deepening, the increase of housing and infrastructures, the increase of water and sanitation supply and of electricity services. And IPCC has already shown us many times how far the adaptation measures can reduce the annual damage that is due to sea level rise. In this picture, we see different time slices. In darker color, the case of no adaptation. In lighter color, the case of adaptation. And three different scenarios of sea level rise. With red, we are showing the worst scenario. With blue, we are showing the lowest scenario. And if we look at some other kind of plots, other kind of data, we can look at what happens with the temperature anomaly that is reported here in Abscissa. We see to the left the people flooded in millions per year. On the top, we see what happens with the coastal protection. At the bottom, with an enhanced protection. The left column and the right column do correspond to different DIM data. And we clearly see how much the enhanced protection can significantly reduce the number of people flooded. If we go to the center, also the flood cost that is reported as billion US dollars per year. If we go to the right, we see also the dike costs, and we see that with a 5 degrees temperature anomaly, the cost of dike upgrade can be up to 50 billions of US dollars per year. On the other side, we know already that traditional flood defenses showed their limitation. We see here some breaches during Hurricane Katrina, the Storm Becky, and the Storm Surge Quinta. And of course, we know that we cannot upgrade the wall crest, the wall height, till an indefinite level. We know that this is negative for ecosystem services and is negative, of course, also in terms of aesthetic impact. So globally, we need a new way to plan the risk reduction strategy to consider multiple line of defenses and combination of types of intervention. This in turn, of course, requires more complex risk models for screening and evaluation. But the kind of approach should be an integrated approach with the nearshore traditional structures like breakwaters and groins, or maybe some kind of restoration of the beach and of the dunes. But we can combine this with new approaches like oysters and coral reefs and the relocation of buildings on the shore and flood warning and evacuation. It is essential indeed that the solutions are people-centered. So to take into account also what is the social awareness and the social perception of risk and how far people do feel protected by the defense system. So we are not looking for a single solution, we are looking for a combination of different types of solutions. This is just a plot showing us the way, we have an initial risk, so an initial risk to people and properties from the effects of extreme events. We can go for zoning, so reduce the exposure to the hazard by avoiding the building in high-risk zones, and we can use specific building codes to reduce the risk. Then we should combine green and gray approaches to, for instance, as mangroves and seawalls, and then further reduce the risks by means of early warning system and evacuation plans. We have then to look at the asset checklist, because indeed the total environmental value of coastal areas is extremely high. So we should preserve the marine life, we should go for swimming safety, preserve the sandy beaches, we would like to have clean and clear water to preserve the ocean view and to get rooms for the water sports. And therefore, we should look for more sustainable approaches as building with nature approaches. These are just a few examples I'm going to look to show you, like permeable dams and mangrove rehabilitation in northern Java, or the kind of new coral barriers built in the Gulf of Mexico with innovative methodologies and support of artificial structures. But we have also the sediment stocks and the sediment budget that can be forced, and then we can use the natural sand transport as with the sand motor, where a mega nourishment has been done, and then the natural sand transport created new beaches and dunes. Another kind of similar approach, the construction of island, marshes and mudflats from sediment accumulated in lake, the so-called Markerbaden, and then the mud motor sent dredged from the Harlingen Harbour to nourish the Badensee salt marshes. These salt marshes are a peculiar ecosystem that can offer strong protection to the inland areas, for these new eco-friendly measures were developed, such as biodegradable materials to support the development of salt marshes. Or also we have other kind of blocks that can be used, for instance, to build breakwaters with pools, with some kind of randomly placed roughness, or even, this is an architect view of our tetrapods with some trees roots to stabilize the system. We can also think of multifunctional structures such as artificial reefs that can be built to protect the beach from erosion, but at the same time for recreational purposes, or harbor protection that can be derived by means of traditional breakwaters, but with the original type of structures that can allow the production of energy as the Dimemo or the Rewe breakwaters. Other multifunctional structures are a specific kind of promenades and infrastructures that can protect the inland from flooding and at the same time offer room for recreation, for transportation and other activities. A new approach is also a multi-hazard defense, like the one in the Living Lab on Antwerpen, where mobile barriers can protect from extreme rainfalls, and at the same time we have the green roofs. So we have green roofs protecting from the extreme rainfalls and mobile barriers protecting from floods that are combined together to offer an advanced protection considering a multi-hazard perspective. If we can make a summary of the strength and of the weaknesses of this kind of defenses, well, we can say that for built systems such as seawalls, levees, bulkheads, we have decades of experience with implementing this approach, with, of course, the design and the build. These structures are ready to withstand a storm as soon as they are constructed. With the natural, so mangrove and coral reef, the ecosystem grows stronger with time once established. They have the potential to self-recover and can be cheaper to construct. With an hybrid approach, such as mega nourishment and artificial reefs, this kind of approach capitalizes on the best characteristics of built and natural, can provide a greater level of confidence than natural alone, and allows for innovative design of coastal protection systems. As for the weaknesses, the built system weakens with time and as a built-in lifetime. It provides benefit when a storm is approaching and can have negative impact on the ecosystem services. The natural system, there is the need to develop best practices on how to restore the ecosystem, can take a long time to provide the necessary protection level, and permitting can be more difficult. If we go for a hybrid concept, there is still more research needed to design the best hybrid system. It can still have some negative impact on species diversity and on ecosystem, and few data on the cost-benefit ratio are available. We see that these kind of approaches are new, innovative, faceted. We have multiple line of defenses, so it's extremely, it's a challenge indeed for a coastal manager to take a decision. A lot of different sectoral development is involved in coastal areas, and we need to prioritize intervention on an impact basis. And also we need to assess which is the best portfolio of adaptation solution. So for this, a spatial dimension is required, but we also need to perform a scenario analysis across different time slices, different kind of environmental conditions. So for this, I've been working within the Theseus and then within the Brigade project on a decision support system, a GIS-based decision support system, that will be delivered by the end of the year at this link, coasts.ing.unibo.it. It is the Coast Decision Support Tool. It has been scoped for Cesenatico, a seaside resort close to my city, to Bologna. And the users will be able to build their site by uploading any kind of data also available across the web. And the steps we followed for building this kind of tool was first to identify and collect harmonized data. So we need, of course, a DTM model, the more accurate as possible. We need the data about the land use, where we have recreational facilities, schools, factories, beaches, and so on. Data about the population, the age, the gender, and the insurance schemes, education level. We need data about the habitats. In case of Cesenatico, just two habitats, Pinewood and Bentos. We need then to define the scenarios and reconstruct them in a simple way. So in this tool, we have the possibility of user-defined scenarios or preset. So we have different time slices, and we can also consider and different wave conditions, different storm surge level. We can account for sea level rise due to climate change. We can include river discharge. We can also simulate rainfall and shoreline erosion by means of a one-line model for open beaches or by uploading a shapefile with the eroded shoreline. We can take into account subsidence and population growth rate and GDP change. So we also account for social and economic changes. Then we can represent different type of solutions of mitigation and adaptation solution. So we have engineering solutions such as breakwaters or wave energy farms or kind of nourishments. We have social solutions like early warning system. We have also ecologically based mitigation as dunes and biogenic reefs and so on. We can edit this mitigation by clicking directly on the map and drawing this, and the input window will allow the user to include the more important data that are needed to run the simplified functions representing the effect of the mitigation on the risk assessment. And then we have a 2D model based on shallow water equations running the flooding model to get the depth, to get velocity and duration of the flood. And then we have to try to combine the vulnerability maps. They are, of course, made based on the impact maps, like the hydraulic vulnerability map built from the flood velocity, depth, and duration. And of course, we need also weights to combine together the critical facility loss and the life loss, and to make the social vulnerability map. And this actually is something that is site-specific. And then, of course, we have land value loss that has to be combined with the beach loss into the economic vulnerability map, and so on. Then the social, economic, and environmental vulnerability maps are combined together into the risk map. At this stage, we have equal weights for this map, but also the user can make their own input with their own weights. But we are not providing the user only with the quantitative result, so with the map of risk. We are also providing the users with indicators. Because in this way, we don't get only some maps to be compared from one scenario to another one, but we can get also a table with some indicators. The indicators are described here to the left. I'm just giving you some example. For instance, the percent flooded area with respect to the total area, or the percent of the area with the Bentos with an AVE greater than 2, or that is more or less the mean value for the AVE, where we have a critical facility loss greater than the 20% with respect to the total critical facilities, or where we have a beach loss percent of given a threshold. So basically, the threshold can be user-defined, can be site-specific, and by running different scenarios, the user can build a kind of table like this one, allowing the user to make comparison, direct comparison between different portfolios, different clusters of solutions, different time slices, different conditions, and the different indicators. So this to say that this tool is not meant, of course, to substitute any kind of detailed analysis, but is meant to provide a support as a preliminary tool for planning these strategies. There are still challenges, of course, in this approach. Of course, there is a need for an harmonization of the data and methods. We are combining together risk mitigation and climate change adaptation. These, of course, have traditionally completely different timescales. We need a better assessment of uncertainty because, of course, there is an inherent uncertainty in the data, but then we have also an uncertainty in the models. We need to combine different spatial scale because the adaptation and mitigation solution and the cost-benefit assessment are usually hybrid solutions kind of data and kind of result, whereas for the environmental scenario, we need a more wide kind of scale, European at least scale. Still, there is the need to include resilience. It's very difficult to represent the resistance in time of different kind of defense strategies. And so far, the tool can present some failure scenarios. And of course, it is incredibly difficult to include a social risk component. We can think of testing the tool with end users, but the risk awareness and perception of the level of defense of different strategies is something that the tool cannot present. So I would like to acknowledge my colleagues supporting this presentation, and especially Professor Leopoldo Franco and Luca Martinelli. A special thank also to Chart Bauma, Irene Colosimo, Luisa Firth, and Dario Simcic. And I would like to thank my team, my two research fellows, Sara Mieta-Formentin and Giuseppina Palma, presenting at this ICCE at session 114 and 121, and my PhD student, Elisa Della Valle. And I would like to thank you all for your kind attention.